Let's turn to Luke chapter 24. Love your topic. Ignite the rekindled heart. That's the first thing I do when somebody asks me to speak. I go, what's your topic? I have to love the topic to say yes. I don't go out that much. But I love any topic in the Bible. I even love the ones where they're just talking about names. I like to find out who all those names were and what they did for the Lord. And this is one of my favorite subjects ever, this portion of scripture of chapter 24 of Luke. It's after the resurrection. Let's pray. Lord, I ask you right now that you would encompass this room, that you would encompass our hearts, that you would dwell in our hearts, that you would reign in our hearts, and that you would cause yourself to be known in a deeper and more passionate way than we have ever known you. In Jesus' name, amen. So what does it mean to have a heart that is ablaze for God? I looked up ignite, and I looked up all these words that mean ignite, and one of them is ablaze. Some of you might not ever have had a burning heart or a passion for God. I remember when I didn't. I remember when Ralph first got saved, and he wanted to go tell the whole world about Jesus, and I'm sitting there thinking, wait a minute, this is wrong. I'm the Christian, and he's the heathen that just got saved, and he's telling everybody about Jesus, and I'm not. Something's wrong. And I literally sat with my Bible and cried, and I told the Lord, I am so sorry. I don't know you. My husband knows you, and he's a new believer. His heart's ablaze for you, and mine isn't. Some of you may have had a passion for God, but now you've lost it. Maybe you desired him, but now you've lost it, and now you're here because you're longing for him. So how do you get this passion back? How do you maintain this constant flow of God, God's tender spirit moving in our hearts and ascending back to the Father and back to the Son and onto the lost world? How do we get that? Well, today you have come to the right place because Marie and the women in this church have sought God on your behalf, and he has put this topic on your hearts. You know, God puts topics on people's hearts, and then you can't get them out. I'm going to be going Tuesday to speak at the pastor's wife retreat, and when they asked us when we got there, what's on your mind? And I said, persecution. That is all that's on my mind. America is suffering persecution. I have Saeed's picture where I brush my teeth every day and comb my hair, and that's on my mind. So that's all I can think about. That's all I can speak on, because God puts those topics, and he put this topic on Marie and the women's hearts, exactly what we need to hear, exactly what I need to hear before I go speak on persecution. God is pursuing all of you right now. He's pursuing me. He wants to ignite our hearts. He wants to fuel that spiritual flame. He made us a spirit within us, and he wants to awaken that spirit with God's passion. He wants to stir that dormant heart. Maybe you're here and your heart's just dormant from trials and horrible things that are happening in life, and you're just like numb, and you need to be ignited. He wants to detonate, that's another one of the words, detonate that fire within us. He wants to light the candle of your heart within you. The Bible says that the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord. He wants to light that candle. He wants to rekindle that fire that's gone out. You know, rekindle is when you take some little bushes and you're rubbing two stones together and making a spark to rekindle that fire. An ignited heart for God. I'm going to put a few descriptions that I wrote down just off the top of my heart. Last night I wrote them down of what it means to me to have an ignited heart. For me, an ignited heart for God means to have an insatiable hunger to know God in all his divine character. Right now, as I'm going through the Bible, and I started reading the one-year Bible about 15 years ago because I wanted to read every word, not just go to my special passages, which I normally do. And now what I'm doing is every name of God that I read, I write it at the top of my one-year Bible because I want to know every name. I want to know who he is. A heart that's passionate for God longs to hear his voice always and know his will for their life always. A passionate heart for God drives us to live the crucified life so that we can be in obedience to him in all things, so that his will be accomplished in our lives. I know that my heart is aflame for God because I follow him closely and earnestly and with a pure and truthful heart. I know when it's aflame because it's not, well, I got to read today, have to sit with God today. I better do it. After all, I'm a pastor's wife, or I'm speaking this week. I better get right with God in a week, or they'll know. The spiritual people out there, they will know. It's true. When I walk in perfect harmony and communion with Christ, with the intent of becoming transformed into his image, my life ignites with passion because I sense his life in me. He ignites my heart. A life that's impassioned for Christ will die for Christ, that he may live through them. And I know that's what Saeed's doing in prison right now, and many other Christians all around the world, is they're dying. They're willing to give their life so that people will see Christ, and they are seeing Christ. It's to be ablaze for God, to be consumed with his holy passion. And what is Christ's holy passion? Have you ever thought of that? It's the salvation of souls. That is it. It's not my will. It's his will in me, saving souls for eternity. In our theme scripture, it's Luke 24:32, one of my favorite scriptures in the whole Bible. This whole chapter is one of my favorite chapters. I was looking last night at how many times I've taught it. Quite a few. Love it. It's, did not our hearts burn within us while he, Jesus, talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us? Two discouraged disciples met Jesus on the road to nowhere, and he ignited their hearts, and their hearts burned as Christ opened the scriptures. And that's how our heart is ignited, is when we spend time with Jesus. Today's theme scripture is embedded in a story of two disciples of Christ that lost their passion for Jesus. He had been crucified. He was missing from the grave where he had been risen. He was just gone. He had resurrected, but they didn't know. They were, who took him? Who stole him? Where is Jesus? A disciple is a follower of Jesus. They had followed him. They were not of the 12 disciples. Of course, we know now there's only 11 because Judas betrayed him. They were of the outer circle, all these other disciples, hundreds of them that followed Jesus. Yet on resurrection morning, they walked away from the cross, discouraged. Jesus met them on their journey away from him, walking away. He had said, wait for me. He had told them, I will resurrect, and wait for me and I will meet you and wait for the Holy Spirit. Yet they went home discouraged. And when he met them, he rekindled their hearts. In their distress, Jesus drew near to them, and he set their hearts aflame with the most instructive, awe-inspiring, intimate moment with him. Every morning when I get up, I have my table where I do devotions, and I look out to the hills, and I grab my cup of coffee, and I go, Lord, I'm here. Meet me. Talk to me. I need an intimate moment with you. Sometimes it's just a word that I read that's just that word that I needed for the day or that instructed me. It's a story of Jesus going out, doing the reason why he came to this earth. He's going out to the highways, and he's going out to the byways, and he's presenting the gospel in a natural and loving and miraculous way. This long piece was probably written after Matthew, Mark, and John, the synoptic gospels. Jesus visited Jerusalem on three different occasions, maybe four. This is one of them, and it is the most vivid and well-recorded, and it was recorded by Luke. No one else recorded, and he just was so intense in the way he did it. Let's see how Jesus met these disciples. The scripture reference is 24. Now, in Luke 24:1-12, we have the resurrection morning. And if we read that, I think I'll just read it real quick. It says, now, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb, and they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened as they were greatly perplexed about this, and behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And we know those were two angels. These women had prepared these spices. They had seen where Jesus had been laid, and they came back, and they're ready to serve him the way they had always done. Then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, these angels, why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here, but he has risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee? saying the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise again. So they reminded them, and they remembered his words. They remembered. Then they returned from the tomb and told these things to the 11 and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and other women with them. The first ones to take the message of the risen Christ were these women, who told these things to the apostles, and their words just seemed as idle tales. Have you ever experienced that? Oh, you don't know what you're talking about. And they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, and stooping down, he saw the linen clothes lying by themselves, and he departed, marveling to himself at what had happened. And John goes on to tell us that John also went in John 20, and he went with to the tomb, and he saw that the tomb is empty, and he believed. So all this excitement is going on, but these two disciples, they've walked away. And we read that in verse 13. And we see here that, now behold, two men were traveling the same day to the village of Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. Now Jesus had resurrected and he was appearing. A lot of people will say, well, we don't know that he really rose from the dead. Well, yeah, he was appearing all over the place. The first appearance was to Mary Magdalene. And that's in Mark 16 and John 20. The second was to the other women disciples in Matthew 28. The third was to Peter right here. In Luke 24:34, we will see that he appeared to him. The fourth is to these two discouraged disciples. So he's not just in Jerusalem appearing, but he says, oops, two of my disciples walked away. I'm going to go out there and I'm going to get them. He appears to them. Then he appeared to all the disciples and to multitudes before his ascension. So it says these two disciples, two of Christ's disciples of the second group, not of the 11 that were in Jerusalem, but another group. And they're on their way to Emmaus. Well, where is Emmaus? It's not on the map. We've tried to find it. They took us to a little town once that was about the same distance from Jerusalem, and they think that's Emmaus, and there's a synagogue there, and I got my picture taken there. But nobody knows where Emmaus, which I think is interesting that it's a secret. It's not towards Jericho. That road is very mountainous, and it's dangerous and rocky, and it's too far. It's not towards Bethlehem. That was a reminder of what they wanted to forget, that Jesus, this man who said he was King of Kings, had lived for them, told them that he was going to rise again, and now he's missing. They didn't go that way. It's not towards Ephraim. That was not a day's journey. That was a very long journey. These two disciples were on their way to no man's land. Did they live there? Have you ever been so discouraged? You're just walking. You're just driving. Yeah, and you don't know where to go. You're just kind of lost because you're so discouraged. That's what Emmaus means. It's a place where you go when you're discouraged. Were they returning to their old lives? It's the road where you go after you have been with Jesus, after you have witnessed Golgotha, the cross. It's the place of death after enduring perplexing sorrow and pain. You're just so down, so discouraged, you're numb. I remember one time when it was after Raul got saved. And I'm telling you some bad things too. and Raul was still kind of an aggressive guy. And I'm just sitting there, I've had it. I thought when he got saved, he was gonna be immediately perfect. I am leaving. I don't know where I'm going, but I'm leaving. So Emmaus was my couch that day. And all of a sudden, my mother, who was very inspired by the Holy Spirit, comes walking in the room. She had a key to my house, but she always knocked. This day, she didn't knock. She just stormed in. I'm laying there on the couch, called Emmaus. And she says, I just want you to know one thing. And that thing is that the most important thing in life is not you. It's not your marriage. It's the will of God. And she walked out. And I thought, the will of God. What about me? It's the road that we take when we can't go on. Think about what is your Emmaus. When discouragement has caused us to lose hope, purpose, vision, our passion for Christ, and we want to just forget the cross. We want to forget what we just went through. Emmaus is where Christ meets us. That's a good thing. After we've had a dark night of the soul. Have you been there? I have. Name it. Emmaus can be a car. It can be a place around the corner of the house where we just sit and veg out and get depressed and think that life is over. Are you there now? Maybe you're there now. The Lord Jesus knows if you're there now. and he's here to meet you. Discouragement robs us from our passion for God. Got to get a hold of myself. I know someone who's going through this right now. That's why I'm emotional about it, but I'll be fine. Unfulfilled dreams empties you from that hope that you once had for life, that you once had in Christ. And it turns to this hopeless discouragement, this emptiness that causes you to doubt God. Think, I thought Jesus loved me. I thought he had a plan. And then it can turn to absolute unbelief. So we can't go there. Then the passion that you once had for God vanishes. Get a hold of yourself. Okay, back. No, don't clap. Don't clap. Okay, I'll get nervous. Now we're going to read 14 through 17. I'll be fine, trust me. And they talked together of all these things, these two disciples, which had happened. And you already know. He walked with us. He taught us. He fed us. He healed the sick. He opened the blind eyes. They beat him. They mutilated him. They crucified him. It's the third day he's not here. They talked about all these things. So it was while they conversed and reasoned that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. So he goes, Jesus leaves Jerusalem, and you see what kind of God he is. Instead of exalting himself, here I am, I've risen. He goes, wait a minute, I'll be right back. I'm going to Emmaus. Of course, he's just appearing here and there and all over the place. He drew near to them, but their eyes were restrained so that they did not know him. And he said to them, what kind of conversation is this that you have with one another that you walk and you are so sad? Now, this is time of the Passover. Millions of observant Jews of the Rome in this Roman Empire were there. Millions of people were traveling. Pilgrims walked the roads. It's like the freeways today, except instead of being in cars, they're walking the roads and they have their bags and their tents and all the stuff they carried in with them to go to the Passover. And it wouldn't be uncommon as you're walking that somebody walks up to you, hey, where are you guys from? What are you doing? So it's normal. He walks up, hey, what are you doing? It's a festive time. And why are you so down and out? And you know what Jesus is thinking. Christ's pursuit of us rekindles our passion for God. Isn't it exciting to know that Christ is pursuing you? I tell people all the time, hey, that are walking to Emmaus, he's after you and he's going to get you. So just stop and talk to him. So it says, while they communed together, Jesus drew near and he went with them. Their hearts were aching. They were wondering how everything they longed for had vanished. Wasn't he going to set up the kingdom? Jesus knows where we are at all times, even if we're not in the inner circle. Isn't that exciting? Even if we're unimportant and we don't even know their names, Jesus knows. And even if you're confused, and even if you're going in the wrong direction, away from Jesus, when he has been so crystal clear that he would rise in 3 days. James 4:8 says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. And their eyes were restrained. They had not been able to recognize him because now mortality had put on immortality. He was in his resurrected state. We will be like that one day. They were walking with Jesus, talking about Jesus, but they didn't know that it was him. Do you remember a time when God drew near to you and you didn't know it? You didn't know it. He was just talking to you and directing you. And then later you go, oh, that was the Lord. I was at the right place at the right time. That was the Lord. That's what was happening to them. When Christ draws near to me, unknown to me, my heart ignites. That's how I recognize him. I just get this excitement. Sometimes I don't even know what it's about, but I just think, he's there. He's there. He's meeting me. He's walking with me. The Sabbath was over, and they were free to leave Jerusalem. Their master was dead. Their hopes were crushed. They could just talk freely on the road about what had just happened. When Christ meets us at our lowest point, he rekindles our passion for him. He says, what manner of communication is this? What are you talking about? Why are you so sad? Now, they thought this was very strange. Jesus sets them up. he gives them, he's going to give them a most in-depth study that they've ever heard about himself. What all the seers and the prophets of old had longed to hear these two little unknown, unnamed disciples, well, one of them we know is Cleophas who? He's going to give them an intense study. I don't know that he ever gave anybody such an intense study. They were despondent, strained, puzzled. The one they believed in, the promised desire, a Messiah, was gone. How could this be? They thought, we loved him. We believed on him. We gave him our hearts and our lives. We followed him. How could he do this to us? It says they were disciples, which means they followed. They were learners. Maybe they sat on the front row. Did he not fit the Old Testament predictions of the coming one? Did he not declare that he was the Son of God, sent from God? Why then didn't he save himself when he saved others? Where were all the disciples from the inner circle? What would they do now, they who believed on him? Who could they possibly believe in now? Who would be the Messiah? Who was he? Would he ever come? There'd been 400 years of silence. They didn't know. If this man could cast out demons and heal the sick and do all this and be such a man before God, and now you're telling me he's not the Redeemer of Israel? We believed it. Are you today confused about who God is? Have the circumstances of life caused you to doubt him? That's what Satan does. He throws so much at us that we just think, God doesn't love me. He does not love me. Maybe you're asking, I thought I brought up children in the ways of God. And if I did that, they would follow him. I asked myself that. I had my younger son, Ryan, and my oldest, who didn't follow God for many years. And I mean, I remember we're all saying, this is very puzzling. I didn't grow up with the Lord, and I have the Lord, and my boys grew up with the Lord, and they don't have the Lord. And Satan starts working at you so that you doubt God. And I never doubted that my boys would not come to the Lord, even if it was on their deathbed, because of the promises of God. I thought I knew God. I thought I knew God, you might ask. I thought I knew what God wanted for my life, and now my life is a turmoil. I thought my marriage would get better as I serve the Lord. I thought the Lord would provide more abundantly, and we have all these, I thought. We're trying to put God in a box of what we wanted God to do in our lives. When he has a perfect plan, he leads us and guides us if we walk that straight, narrow path into his plan. And everything he wants for us comes right into that path. We don't have to go out looking for it. It's right in front of us. Christ's pursuit for those of us from the outer circle, the unnamed, rekindles our passion for him, as I shared. Now we're going to read from 18 to 21. Then one of those, whose name was Cleophas, we know his name, answered and said to him, are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? Have you not known the things that happened in these last days? He says, where are you coming from that you don't know what's been happening? And he said to them, what things? He wanted them to talk. Sometimes God asks us questions, and oh, God, you know what I'm going through. Well, what things? So they said to him the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty indeed, and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, I'm going to keep reading. Besides all this, today is the third day since these things happened. So when I read that years ago, I go, hello, it is the third day he has risen. Why are you in Emmaus? Why are you not back in Jerusalem looking for him there? So we see that the other disciple is a name. We don't know who he was. People have thought, was this Dr. Luke? Is this why he wrote it? Was Luke one of the ones that walked away? We don't know. Jesus knows our name and how many hairs are on our head. He knows everything about us. He numbers our days, and he has ordained for each one of us, whether we're known or unnamed. He knows everything about us, and he has a plan for us. So he leaves the name of one of them out. Maybe it was Luke. I like to think it is, but I don't know. Because it's written, I mean, every detail is in this story. The other one, Cleophas, well, there's a woman at the foot of the cross whose husband was Cleophas. Maybe it was him. We don't know. but we know that they were disciples. Despondency robs us from our passion for God. They go, are you only a stranger that you don't know? There were around 1 million people in Jerusalem, and there was only one thing everybody was talking about, the death and passion of Jesus. The man who had claimed to be Savior of the world was dead. The one who Pilate had written, King of the Jews, is dead. Everybody knew. Jesus was not insignificant. That's why they're wondering, what are you talking about? Jerusalem had heard about him since his humble birth. How did they hear? Well, he was in a manger, but there was these angels, these shepherds that said that these angels appeared to them. The priests and scribes in Herod's palace had confirmed the scriptures that yes, indeed, a king would be born in Bethlehem. The Herod had asked them. Everybody knew what was going on with Herod and his court and the chief and priests. It was well known that by the time Jesus was 2 years old, these wise men, kingmakers, came from the east. They were the astrologers. They were the doctors. They were the ones that studied the prophecies of old. They had come of all things following a star, and they had found Jesus lying in a manger. Everybody knew. Jesus continued to allow himself to be known. Well, how do you know that, Sharon? Well, everyone knew, because Herod, when he found out, he went out and had, when he found out there was a newborn ruler, he went out and had all the children killed in Ramah, which is the Bethlehem area, while Jerusalem, the Bible says, trembled with fear. Everybody knew about this man. Many hated him with a passion, others loved him with a passion, but now the passion is gone because this man that we knew so much about is dead. And they had said, you can see here how they had lost their hope. They had lost their trust in Jesus. They said, oh, well, didn't you hear about Jesus of Nazareth? Well, Nazareth is like saying Jesus from nowhere. Nazareth was a forsaken town. It was despised. Pontius Pilate had put on the cross, Jesus from Nazareth. Jesus from a nowhere town, not from a king, not from a palace, not from Jerusalem, not Jesus the son of David, but Jesus from Nazareth, king of the Jews. Philip had told Nathanael, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? So we know it was pretty despised. Christ identified with us at birth, didn't he? He came to Nazareth in a manger, lowly, and he was raised as a carpenter throughout his life. Notice they didn't proclaim him to say, well, Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, is missing. Jesus, the son of David, King David, is missing. Jesus, the promised Messiah. Jesus, the son of God. Jesus from the despised town. And a lot of times we go, well, Jesus, and not my King, the Lord of Lords, is the one. And they said, he said all these things. But look at their testimony to this unknown man. Well, this guy Jesus that seemed to be a prophet, notice what they said. So we see their heart there. When Jesus asked Peter who he thought Jesus was, Peter had passionately declared, thou art Christ, or the coming Messiah, the promised Messiah, the son of the living God. He said he was a prophet, mighty indeed. Well, there were a lot of prophets from the beginning of time. Perhaps they had not known, truly known, the crucified one intimately. The scripture says, Paul wrote, I want to know him in his suffering. I want to get to know him. Not only in his resurrection, we want to know him then, but I want to know him in his suffering. He was a lot more than that, and they were soon going to find out. He was going to be the Redeemer of Israel, they said. They were first century believers, and the scriptures had taught them that the Messiah would come one day and rule as a monarch from Jerusalem and bring peace to the world. And that is true. He will come. He will rule the world. But also, the scriptures had taught that he was Messiah, the suffering servant. In Zechariah 9:9, he would come lowly and riding as a donkey. It was hard for them to believe that Christ would come that way. In Isaiah 53, it had been declared that he would be stricken, smitten of God, afflicted, wounded for our transgressions. But it was hard to believe that the Messiah would come so lowly and so beat up. So were there two Messiahs, the ruling monarch and the suffering servant? Most people wanted the ruler. Dullness of hearing his word robs our passion from God. Now, a lot of people are down on the one-year Bible because they feel like they have to, and then you're dull in the word. And I'm not pushing the one-year Bible. I think everybody needs, for me, it was important because I've read through 15 times. I love that. My grandma had, she'd always say, I'm on my 48th time of reading through the Bible. And I'd think, okay, grandma, I'm going to catch up one day. But no matter how you're reading the Bible, whether it's the one, you know, don't go by the, you know, just go slow. If you get stuck on a word, stay there. Don't be dull of hearing. We need to hear what he says. And apparently, they had been dull of hearing. And they said, and now it's the third day. And then in verses 22 through 24, we'll read it real quick. Yes, and certain women of the company, certain women, not certain women, the disciples that had followed him and taken care of his needs, who arrived at the tomb early, astonished us. So they had already heard. When they did not find the body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels. They didn't say a vision. They said, we saw two men in shining garments. They'd seen angels who said he was alive. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found that it was just as the women had said. But him they did not believe. So here they're confessing that the women had seen these two men in shining garments that had said, why are you seeking? We read it here. Why are you seeking the living around the dead? And they astonished us. But they were dull of hearing. Maybe they didn't want to hear. It was too miraculous. It was too big. They had their facts confused, and they had walked away from Golgotha. The women had lingered at the tomb. Where are they going to put him? We'll be back. We will continue taking care of Messiah, not understanding. We will continue, but remembering that when the angels saw them, that he did say he would rise again. They had lingered. We need to linger with Christ, with the word, when we don't understand. And they became the first to witness the Lord, to witness the story of the Lord. And they were the first to go and to take the message to the disciples so they didn't find his body. Now we're going to go from 25 to 27. Then he said to them, oh, foolish ones and slow of heart. Whoa, does the Lord talk like that to us? Yes. I've told the Lord many times, okay, just let me have it. I'm ready. And then he comes back lovingly, and other times he just tells me off royal. What are you doing? Oh, foolish ones. Yes, we're absolute fools when we're not listening to, first of all, what he had said, and then to wait and linger at the tomb. The only reason the women didn't stay all night is because it was the Sabbath. Otherwise, they would have just sat there and waited to watch him raised from the grave. Slow of heart to believe all that the prophets had spoken. They had just said he was a prophet, mighty indeed. They didn't believe all that the prophets had spoken. Ought not the Christ, the Messiah, the coming one, the anointed one, have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? The suffering servant, was he not to come and suffer? And he's talking to them like, you know better. You followed me. You heard the messages. You heard when I told you I was the Son of God and I would rise in 3 days. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Now that's the Calvary Chapel verse right there. Because what do at Calvary Chapel? We, and not only us, many other denominations around the world and people, read the Bible line upon line and study it and meditate on it. So he went from the prophets and gave them the most amazing study. And I'm hoping that one day I get to hear that study. I hope it can be repeated. He exhorted them. He first rebuked them for their unbelieving hearts. He healed their sick souls. He took time to hear them out first, and then he expounded all these events that had happened to him. He healed their soul. He drew them to himself. Watch how he does it. He restored their passion for him, knowing their hearts. He ministered to their most intimate need. Now, notice the way he does it in such a natural way. He's walking along like everybody else. He questions them. They start telling him what their problem is, and then he rebukes them. You're foolish. You should have listened. And they probably immediately said, yeah, we were foolish. We didn't listen. He will chasten us in order to keep us close to his heart. We don't like when we're chastened. The exposition of his word makes our heart ablaze for him. Jesus used the title. He said Messiah had not, ought not the Christ to have suffered. He didn't use one of his manhood titles, boy, baby, son of man, friend, brother, Galilean, Nazarene, and those are his titles. But he used the title that they knew about, that he was the coming Messiah. He expounded all the scriptures and the things concerning himself. That is amazing. He expounded systematically the way things were written in the Bible to them. Now we'll go 28 through 33. Then they drew near to the village where they were going. So they were getting close to Emmaus. And he indicated that he would have gone farther. He said, well, okay, you guys, I'm not going to Emmaus. He doesn't go to Emmaus. He takes us out of Emmaus. I'm not going to go lay on the couch and be a couch potato and let you feel sorry for yourself. He goes, I'm going to go further. But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening and the day is spent. And he went in to stay with them. Now it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, that he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were open, and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to one another, here's our theme verse. Did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us? So they rose up that very hour. Notice what happens immediately. First, they're depressed, walking to Emmaus. Now they jump up that very hour, and they returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together. This is what meeting with God does to us. It resurrects us. It makes us. It ignites our hearts, and we get up. He took time to tarry with them and break bread. And I've always wondered, what did he do in that breaking of bread that they recognized him? He let them recognize him. We're to be like Christ and take time to spiritually dine with him. And not only with him, but with those who are losing their passion for Christ. We're to sit and take time with them and expound to them the scriptures. Sometimes we get impatient as Christians. Oh, I've told her a million times about Jesus. You know, I'm not going to tell her again. I'm over it. I'm done. Let Jesus reach her. Well, that's good. He will, and you won't get used. We are to be like Christ and take time. Moved by her passion for God, I want to bring in Kay. Kay met us year after year on that narrow path, and she left footprints clearly marked for us to walk in. She sat and feasted with us in the Word. This is Pastor Chuck's wife, Kay, for those of you who may not know. She has set my heart ablaze for Christ time and time again. And I had a mother that did it, and a grandmother that did it, and a neighbor that did it. Revelation 3:20 says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I'll come into him, and I will sup with him. Psalm 27:8, then you said, one of Kay's favorite scriptures was, seek my face. When you said, seek my face, my heart responded to you and said, Lord, I will, thy face will I seek. Jesus will draw near to us as often as he needs to, as it takes to prepare our spiritual life in order that he can use us, in order that we can have that his passion for souls, and he can use us to tell others. The days are coming to a close. I don't know if you watch the news. I watch the news every day. I sit down, even if it's before I go to sleep, I'll sit down and I watch, and we are living in terrible days. Persecution is now in America, as you well know. Just yesterday, I'm working on my study for persecution for the pastor's wives. Just yesterday, a murderer in Oregon went into a school, and he had three or four guns with him, and he had more at home, and he told the kids in a room, well, they were adults and young kids, and he said, if you're a Christian, I want you to stand up. And they would stand up, and he'd shoot them in the head. And he shot 9 of them in the head, and 7 were wounded. So I don't know if they just didn't say, and anybody who wasn't a Christian, he would shoot him in the leg. So he was filled with hatred, but he had demons in him, not Satan, that he knew he wanted to kill Christians in the head. Persecution is here. I'm not going to get into that because I could, but we better be ready. And the only way we're going to make it through is to draw close to Jesus. It says their eyes were open. He then disappeared. Our resurrected body will be like that when we are corruption puts on incorruption. One glimpse of him is all we need to set our hearts on fire with passion for him and give eternal hope and understanding. He will give us that eternal hope and understanding in the deepest and most intimate chamber in our hearts. They said, did not our hearts burn? When we take time for Jesus and walk and talk with him, our hearts will burn. Now, many times you're just reading and you just read, nothing happens. But then you see yourself walking in the right direction. You see yourself sharing with the Lord. You know that you have spiritual understanding of things that others don't. When we spend time with him, he will become the consuming fire burning away our fears and unbelief. He will become the light of the world and lightening our darkened path. We walk in darkness until he lights our path. He will become the bright morning star that will guide us to our eternal home. He is that torch from heaven that leads us onward. He is the love of our life, drawing us to him. Divine encounters with the resurrected Lord will give us passion for souls, and that's in the closing couple scriptures, 33 through 35. Now they rose up that very hour. They had walked all day. I think it was like 7 miles to Emmaus. All day they had walked, and they returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together. So they were there waiting. What do we do now? They killed him. They're going to kill us. I mean, you can imagine what the conversation was. He said he was going to rise. Will we see him? Will we know? Saying, and then, because we know that was happening before, but here in 34 it says, and they were saying, the Lord is risen indeed, and he's appeared to Simon. So after he appeared to these Emmaus, or before to these two guys, he had appeared to Simon Peter, and they told about the things that had happened on the road to Emmaus and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread. So there was something about, this is my body broken for you. I've always wondered how amazing that time was. Now, when we take communion, it just seems so normal in the church. We take the bread, put it, and then the wine, and it just seems so mechanical. One thing I've learned to do to really make me think about communion with Christ is I take that bread and I crush it in my hand and I go like this. I think people around me probably think she's Looney Tunes, but I do. And I say to myself, I broke his body. And then I drink the cup and I go, I caused him to bleed. I try to remember. But there was something about the way he did it, I don't know how he did it, that they recognized him in that breaking of bread. They turned back from their unbelief, their fears, their questioning. Their hearts were ignited for him. Now they were with the other disciples. They were excited. They were talking about Jesus. They went back to Jesus, believing in him. They went back to Jerusalem where he told them to wait, to their spiritual home. They went back to the cross. They went back to the tomb, which were those eternal symbols of the gospel. They found the 11, and they were saying, guess what? He appeared to Peter. They all began to fellowship and to speak to one another the great things that God, the things he had done. Well, remember when he said this, remember when he said that. I didn't know if I should believe him, but now I know how he was the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God, how he had fulfilled the prophecies concerning himself. They were exclaiming the gospel to each other. As you read through the Old Testament in the New Testament, God will reveal things to you. The other thing I'm doing on my pages this year is whenever I see the Father, God the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit in the same verse, I write triune God. Even though it doesn't say they're triune God, but they're all listed. It's all over the place. It's all over the place that talks about the triune God. When our hearts burn with passion for Christ, we unite with believers worldwide in one sole purpose, and that is to bring glory to God. When our hearts are consumed with passion for Christ, we become one with him. We walk with him. We talk with him. We share with him. And become one with his holy passion for souls. I get tired of traveling, but I go to South America, I go to Colombia, and I go out to the jungles, and it's hot, it's uncomfortable, there's bugs. And when I'm planning a trip, I'm usually kind of, oh, I can't believe it. I have to do this. I can't believe that God's called me to do this. But I can't stop it. There's this passion in me that just makes me go. I can't think of not going. And when I get there, I can feel that he's walking with me as we're sharing the gospel in South America. Jesus longs to have a personal encounter with you when you're on your road to nowhere. He wants you to sense his awesome presence and flood your heart with his sacrificial love. He died on the cross, and he has set you free from death and hell. And he's going to pursue you till he sets your heart ablaze for him. That is what he longs to do. Through the scriptures, he wants to answer all your questions because they testify of him. A moment with the Lord is going to raise you up from that road of desperation and confusion and emptiness and nothingness. It's going to set your feet on the highway of holiness, the highway that leads to his eternal home where we will be with him forever. So today, don't be discouraged. Look for him everywhere. I look for him on signs, on trucks, on license plates, on in the sky, you know, everywhere. Just, where are you, Lord? I go out and I look at the stars and I go, is that the New Jerusalem or is it that over there? Where is it? Look for him everywhere. Let him exhort you. Commune with him always, 24/7. And you'll be loving one another and you'll be fulfilling his call in your life, which is the salvation of souls. I'd like you to bow your heads right now. I know that God has spoken to you through his Holy Spirit. That's who he uses to speak to us. You know what area he has touched. I want you to give that to the Lord right now. If you're on that road to Emmaus right now, tell him. He knows it already, but acknowledge it. Lord, I am in Emmaus. I am on the couch. I am vegging. I am down. Lord, meet me. Make yourself known to me. Uncover my eyes. I know you're here, but I haven't seen you. Make yourself known to me. Please, I need you. This last year, when I was younger, I would, not that I don't do this now, but I don't do it as much. I would have these long, involved prayers, and a lot of them were about me. This last year, my prayer has gotten very short. It's, Lord, help. Just help me. Help my sons. Help the world. Help the non-believer. Just help. And I thought, am I sinning by having such a short prayer? And then you read through the Psalms, and David is always, help, 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 help. He was always crying out, help. And I'm not telling you just to pray that prayer, but we really need help, don't we? We need help to come out of unbelief, doubt. We need help with our families, with our husbands. And the time is coming in America when we need help. And somebody might put a gun in front of us and say, are you a Christian? Because if you are, I'm going to shoot you right now. And you're going to declare, yes, I am. I know Christ.